As healthcare managers, one of our constant focuses will be to manage risk. So why should we worry about healthcare laws and ethics? Every step we take, every decision we make, determines who we are. Our ethical makeup, our morals and values dictate how we run our lives. Every decision has consequences. And most of the time, innocent people are the ones who end up paying the ultimate price. In healthcare, we're not only dealing with monetary assets, we are also dealing with the lives. Lives that could either be enhanced or even destroyed by our actions. Is it worth it to destroy others in order to make a few extra dollars? We as healthcare professionals have to do everything possible to protect our patients and fragile clients from predators that their only intent is to enrich themselves, regardless of who they destroy in the process. Most criminals do not start with robbing a bank or killing someone purposely. They start with small petty crimes of opportunity, compromising their ethics and stretching their morals one inch at a time. Some healthcare professionals start by getting paid for referrals, then move up from there. Money is sweet and easy to obtain.
Who could be involved in Medicare or Medicaid fraud, waste, and abuse? Anyone with a motive, means, and opportunity can commit fraud, waste, and abuse. Some examples are physicians, nurses, and other healthcare providers, patients or beneficiaries, plan sponsors, insurance agents or brokers, hospitals, home health agencies, laboratories, drug manufacturers, health plans, pharmacies, durable medical equipment, DME, providers, pharmacy benefits managers, PBMs, criminal syndicates, anyone who bills Medicare or Medicaid. Let's look at some of the fraudsters whom the Office of the Inspector General, the crime. Nashville Pharmacy Services, LLC, and owner Kevin Hartman overbilled Medicare and TennCare for pharmacy services, dispensing HIV and AIDS-related medications. Estimated loss, $7.8 million. The crime. Dr. Farid Fata, hematologist and oncologist, misdiagnosed cancer, then prescribed expensive intravenous therapies, medications, and diagnostic tests for these patients. Estimated loss, $17 million.
Imagine you're walking into a busy hospital. You take a moment to relax, to try to forget about the reason you're there. Chemo. You're getting treated for cancer. But at least Dr. Fata is there to take care of you.
His education and experience is unparalleled, second to none.
A nurse takes you to the last open seat in the house. You sit back and take a deep breath as the drugs begin to drip into your veins.
But I remember looking in that infusion suite and thinking about how these patients have no idea what's happening to them.
What you don't know is that today is the last day you'll ever sit in this chair.
The doctor that I trusted my life with would forever change my view of the word doctor, who takes an oath to do no harm.
This is a story of over 500 patients who put their trust in a prominent oncologist.
He would look them in the eye and lie to them and say, "You have cancer."
And a system that enabled him to hurt people for nearly a decade.
I did encourage my mom to endure it. I did, but I did it for her to live, not for her to die.
Angela Swantek is an oncology nurse. So upset, she came forward to 7 Action News about her experience with Dr. Fada. She was up for a position, she says, in his office 3 years ago. Swantek decided to go to the office to see if she would like to work there. But what happened in a matter of an hour and a half left her sick to her stomach. According to Swantek, she couldn't believe how patients were being treated there and said there was also gross neglect.
Chemotherapy being infused at inappropriate times. So something that should go over 15 minutes, he ordered to be done in an hour or two. Things just being infused incorrectly. So as a nurse, I went home and I went online and I printed out the form and I turned him into the state medical board.
She complained to the state medical board, but she got a letter later saying there was no wrongdoing found and, quote, the public health code could not be established to support disciplinary proceedings. Swantek wonders what more she could have done.
Yeah, stakeholders. Dr. Fada, the defendant, 553 victims, identified victims and their families, Medicare, of course, the federal government and taxpayers, of course, at the end of the day, taxpayers are the one who end up footing the bill for everything that people steal from Medicare. The Michigan Department of Licensing Regulatory Affairs, because they're the ones who deny the investigation, and Dr. Fada's wife, she was acting as a CFO, the whistleblower. No one paid attention at all. He had a stellar reputation, so not many people questioned or suspected him and his behavior. Employees were complicit or afraid and did not do anything to report him. And the ones that did were ignored. Despite all the red flags and warnings, he continued to do as he pleased. Nothing happened. The employees at the oncology clinic had the duty to report the abuse that was happening to the patients, especially the elderly patients and patients that were taken off hospice and put back into chemotherapy. They had the duty and they did nothing. The whistleblower.
I couldn't believe what was in front of me. I couldn't believe what I was seeing. George Karace took a new job in 2011. I was an office manager for an oncology practice. Dr. Farid Fada had a rapidly expanding practice in suburban Detroit. But within 2 years, one of the other oncologists and two nurse practitioners announced they were leaving. Karace confronted that other oncologist.
Are you leaving? And he said, yes. And I said, can I ask you why?
What the doctor told George Karace about Dr. Fada was a bombshell.
Patients were given chemotherapy and other treatments when they didn't have cancer. I was determined to have this doctor stop harming people.
His head spinning, George contacted an attorney he knew who handled whistleblower cases. George believed he might have a strong one.
We've heard a lot of strange stories about fraud, but that one was beyond fraud. It was cruel. It was criminal. It was risking people with poison.
David Heron wasted no time. He called the Department of Justice.
Without a doubt, this is the fastest and most intense lawsuit I've ever handled in this area.
In 2013, after he learned what was going on, Karace filed the federal whistleblower lawsuit.
I think he was very successful with compartmentalizing staff and creating an element of fear among his staff.
President, here's a list of 3 cases. One of them was Dr. Zamora, who was basically diagnosing patients with a rare disease and submitted actually and given him chemotherapy too as well. So he was convicted in Texas. For the first time ever, there's precedent for a murder conviction against a doctor. Dr. Sui Ying Lisa was found guilty of a second degree murder and the first time a doctor has been convicted of a murder in the United States. She's from Rolling Heights, California. She was sentenced for 30 years to life in prison for the murder of three of her patients. Case analysis and potential criminal and civil liabilities. Even though he was charged and sentenced to 45 years in prison, he was not charged with all the laws he violated. There was many other ones that he should have been charged with or had the potential to be charged with, and also to the other stakeholders as well. According to Harris, 2014, it states that criminal law refers to wrongs against society as a whole. Evidently, the actions committed by Dr. Farah were wrong against society as a whole, as more than 553 patients were administered chemotherapy even when they had no cancer. He defrauded Medicare and other insurance companies, leaving the taxpayers responsible for millions of dollars in losses. Crimes against individuals. The case doesn't only consist of crimes against society. It may also include civil liabilities that are based on the crimes against individuals. Dr. Farah exhibited actions that are forms of both intentional and unintentional torts. The infusion of chemotherapy drugs to healthy patients was beyond the scope of duty. This medical professional was obligated to follow. He displayed the four components of unintentional torts: duty, breach of duty, causation, and damages. His gross negligence resulted from the lack of care and regard for patient safety, resulting in the injuries such as long-term damage, broken bones, loss of teeth, and even death from application of unnecessary chemotherapy. As a healthcare professional, he did not uphold an appropriate standard of care that is determined by what other professions will have reasonably do in a similar situation. Potential intentional torts in this case include assault and battery. He assaulted his victims as he injected them with heavy doses of chemotherapy, causing them physical harm. Fraud, deceitful practice in according and insurance billing. Medical malpractice is considered to be a type of negligence, even though it's rare. In this case, the doctor was premeditated and negligent to the point of malpractice. Respondent superior may only apply to the hospitals in which Dr. Farah was affiliated with. There is no more information about the extent of their involvement or if any of the treatments were administered at any of the hospitals. But if there was, then it will apply to them. An intentional tort. Causation could be used to prove how easy it is for the patients to prove that their injuries were a direct cause of Dr. Farah negligence when their lives were compromised as they were given chemotherapy when the test showed no cancer at all. There were serious damages, including the loss of life, caused by the chemotherapy treatments that were administered to these patients. He failed to act as an ordinary and prudent healthcare professional within the same community who act in similar circumstances. He is guilty of breach of duty. If a procedure outcome is what the patients did not anticipate or inform about, this may be considered negligence that falls under breach of duty. Under breach of duty, Dr. Farah acted with malfeasance, negligence, and malintent. In this case, negligence is so obvious that the burden of proof shifts to the defendant in proving they are not responsible for the injury. So it is fairly to say that the doctrine of recipsa licitor, The things speaks for itself. An intentional tort is applicable in this case. He intentionally committed fraud with the intent and knowingly dispensed drugs and misled his patients to believe that they were receiving treatment they needed, even though the doctor used informed consent and the patient's implied consent and agreed to the treatment consent. This does not protect him because it was done under false pretenses. Patients will have consented to the treatment if they knew the treatment was unnecessary. They were not able to give informed consent in this case. Dr. Farah displayed a breach of duty by not following his oath as a healthcare provider by disregarding patient safety and well-being. Generally, most crimes require an element of intent. For example, one must intend the death of another in order to be charged with most forms of murder. In most cases, a doctor or other medical professional does not intend to kill a patient. So, absent some unusual circumstances that will establish a motive, intent is usually not present, and thus most forms of murder will not apply. It is possible, however, to commit a criminal homicide based on reckless behavior. In other words, if someone acts with such a disregard for the safety of others that death or serious injury is almost a given, this is often enough for certain types of criminal charges. Homicidal and manslaughter. The victim's deaths were caused by Dr. Farah's recklessness and negligent acts, even if there was no intent to cause harm. Potential constructive manslaughter charges. In this case, he killed some of his patients without intent, and in the course of committing an unlawful act, medical fraud, the malice involved in the crime was transferred to the killing, resulting in a charge of manslaughter. This doctor clearly had no moral ethics and violated the normative ethics principle as he broke the standard of right and wrong determined by society, Golden's rule. Do unto others as you will have them do unto you. Fraud, waste, and abuse laws, regulatory laws. False Claims Act. He was charged with a fraud and could have been charged with more counts under False Claims, the False Claims Act, as there was more than enough evidence. The anti-kickback law, there was enough evidence to charge him with many violations of the anti-kickback law in connection to the following companies: Guardian Angel Hospice, Guardian Angel Home Health, Vitas Hospice, in exchange for his referrals of patients to those facilities. They could add more counts on these charges. The Stark Law. There was not enough evidence to prove that he violated the Stark Law, but according to court documents, he had contracts with other providers who he was paying off and who created false reports. So this is a violation, but looks like there was not enough proof to potential criminal and civil charges for other stakeholders. Samar Fatah, Fatah's wife, who was the CEO of Doctors Enterprise, she could have been charged with money laundering, conspiracy to pay, and receive kickbacks. She was aware of everything that was going on. The only way that she could protect herself is if she had used the Python rule and document everything for her own protection. The hospice companies, they could be charged with anti-kickbacks with the kickbacks. But not only that, hospice company, that employees could be charged with the kickbacks laws, and the companies under the respondent superior. And also the Michigan Department of Licensing and Regulatory Affairs could be charged with potential civil liabilities under the tort of negligence. They ignore the complaint done by the nurse Angela Swatek, and they failed to act. They did nothing. Do the crimes fit the punishment? No, they do not. He got away easy, still got arrested, and will spend most of his life in prison, but he did. What he did is unspeakable. He should have been convicted of far, far more serious crimes.
Judgment day for the doctor who caused so much pain. Victims of Dr. Fareed Fata holding hands outside the courthouse in Detroit. Fareed was sentenced today to 45 years in prison. Victims united in their defiance.
45 years for the lives that he took.
It just wasn't enough.
50-year-old Fata pleaded guilty to 13 counts of healthcare fraud, one count of conspiracy to receive kickbacks, and two counts of money laundering.
All of us can understand the kind of trust that we have to put into a doctor to help us through the most difficult times of our lives. And so it's difficult to imagine the kind of betrayal that someone must feel when they find out that the doctor not only lied to them about the kind of treatment that was necessary, but lied to them about whether they ever had cancer at all.
And for the unsuspecting patients, devastating consequences.
I twitch all the time, I shake.
To me, this is almost like he was doing genocide.
How could you do that to anyone? And my family.
What? For most cancer patients, the enemy is the disease that they vow to fight. In this case, the doctor was the enemy in disguise.
The solution. There's not a simple solution, but different ways to approach it. How can this be prevented from happening again?
The U.S. government has taken a strong stand against fraud, waste, and abuse in the healthcare system via the Affordable Act, aka Obamacare, and significantly amended existing anti-fraud statutes. These provisions established fundamental expectations for compliance, disclosure, transparency, and quality of care by healthcare providers. One of the major changes to the healthcare system to help combat fraud, waste, and abuse has been the transition from fee-for-service, FFS, to value-based purchasing, VBP. Healthcare reimbursements were previously done through a system called fee-for-service, FFS. This means the healthcare provider billed Medicare or Medicaid for the service that was rendered. A lot of fraud, waste, and abuse cases stemmed from this system. To combat this, healthcare providers are now transitioning to a value-based purchasing, VBP, system that focuses on quality patient care. This program enhances a healthcare provider's effectiveness in providing care by measuring their performance based on a set of identified metrics. An added benefit of this system is that it is estimated to extend the life of Medicare's trust fund by another 13 years, for example, up to 2030. The following agencies have been collaborating to combat and reduce fraud, waste, and abuse in the U.S. Medicare and Medicaid healthcare system.
In order to make sense of my mother's death, I need to prevent this from happening in the future.
And Michelle Menarino is doing that by testifying before legislators. State lawmakers are pushing bills that would permanently seize the licenses of doctors who purposefully break the law. It comes after former Oakland County doctor Fareed Fata was charged with 16 counts of healthcare fraud and admitted to prescribing bogus chemo to patients, some who didn't even have cancer, to get kickbacks from Medicare.
For the first time, I truly felt like they were getting it today.
Today, former patients and their families gathered and spoke not only about the importance of this new legislation, but what they say was a lack of action by the state when complaints about the doctor were first raised.
Find out what went wrong and fix it. That's what we need to do so that this doesn't happen. I can't bring my sister back, but I can help the state make sure it doesn't happen again.
For Fata victims still alive.
I didn't have cancer.
But he was treated anyway.
I'd really be in pain. A couple of days, I didn't want to get out of bed. It hurt so bad.
Today, he says,
It's a start.
At Justin.